alaikum. Welcome to Grounded Voices. TwoCircles.net is beginning a new talk series where we will speak to notable voices across India, discussing the issues the marginalized communities facing and highlighting these issues through our platform. I'm Hanina, and in this session, joining with me now is Kannan Gopinathan, the ex-IAS officer who resigned from his post in response to the abrogation of Article 370 in Kashmir. Sir, it's a pleasure speaking to you. Welcome to Grounded Voices.
Thank you for having me.
So, let me begin with, right now there is an FIR filed against you for refusing to rejoin back to the duty as directed by the government during an ongoing pandemic. What do you say to your critics who are accusing you for not providing service to the nation in the middle of a crisis?
Okay, in fact, there are two FIRs, not just one. There is another FIR prior to this one was done in Rajkot in Gujarat, where it was for, in fact, criticism on the Prime Minister for taking one day salary out from doctors during the pandemic. So I had written a tweet like, it's a shameful thing to do during a pandemic to have a one day salary cut of the doctors. Mm-hmm. It's like, taking a salary cut of soldiers when they are, fighting a war. When they are fighting a war, if you're having a salary cut of theirs, even if it's a one day voluntary mandatory kind of a cut. So I had written that it is, I am ashamed to even say shameful anymore. It is beyond that. And for that, they have filed an FIR in Rajkot. It is a more serious in the sense it's a non-bailable and kind of an affair they have put. Then after that, they have filed an affair in Daman on this thing that I have not joined the duty back, which is despite being asked to, especially when they had quoted the Disaster Management Act and the Epidemics Act in the letter they had sent to me to rejoin. The critic part, you asked a question as to what do you say to the critic. See, it is because of this feeling that, the call was for me to serve during the pandemic. That was not the case. If that was the case, I would have definitely gone. And if that was the case, they would have taken my service as a volunteer also. They wouldn't have wanted me as an IAS only. I have very clearly offered in my letter. I could have just ignored their letter also. Instead, I wrote on the letter because I wanted to go. If there is manning a control room, anything that they wanted me to do, I would have very clearly said, yes, I'm ready to do as a volunteer, but not as an IAS officer anymore. That's all. So if they wanted my service, I'm ready. Even today, I'm ready anywhere to serve, but not as an IAS officer. And that's my decision. I don't think government can force me to take a position on that.
And at the time of your resignation in August last year, you have said that the real problem we face is not the lack of space for dissent, but the people who are not exercising it. You also said that there is nothing going to happen if we stand up and speak. It's our country. But now 1 year has passed. Do you still stand on your position that the problem we face is not exercising the dissent?
Of course, I still do. When we say that, we have to express our opinion, act on our conscience. What I said was, we should act on our conscience, regardless of the consequences. So the consequences of something. An FIR against me is a consequence that I have known. It is not that I don't know. They would put me in jail, which is fine. I am not running away from that part. If they want to go to the extent of putting me in jail, they can put me in jail. I have no issues. But that doesn't mean I will not speak up. Because why I'm doing what I'm feeling is correct. That is where, when you're acting on conscience, it is not going that you're going to jail, go to jail for a murder or a rape or a theft or, you've done something wrong. You've not done anything wrong. You just said what is in your mind and you've not harmed anybody's sentiments. You said where the government is wrong. So this is a position that we have to take, in a sense that any of the actions, especially when you are taking up on a strong government, I think I've said it multiple times during the period also, especially when you're taking a strong government, it's not that the government is not going to do anything about it. No, it is going to. But the history or the time is not stopping here. The time moves on. If you look at emergency period, there were you know, lakhs of people who were arrested under MISA. A lot of people were arrested under, you know, Maintenance of Internal Security Act. The current government is using UAPA, that Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, just like the Indira government used MISA during that period, to just arrest anybody who can, you know, oppose or to coerce anybody who is taking a stand. But these consequences should not worry us. When we say it is our country, that means it is our responsibility to stand up. When we say it is our belief, it's our responsibility to say about our belief freely. Of course, there will be consequences. But unless we express it, unless we express our dissent, how do we come over it? We won't be able to do it. So that is still my position. And this is what I want to tell also, that consequences would be there, but those are temporary. What we are fighting for is a much larger cause. So you don't, if you have to go to a place and let's say the road is a little rough, you don't not go. You go, of course, you know that the road is rough, you would still go. You know, those inconveniences along the way is fine, it will be there, but you have to reach the destination.
Yeah. And as you said, as you're repeatedly saying that dissent should be seen as an alternate view of what's good for the country. But now students, activists, journalists are being accused of being a part of Delhi violence conspiracy case, charged under stringent laws. How do you see the threats we face against this state of freedom of expression in the country right now?
See, Delhi, it has been beyond one's expectation, I would admit, because the way the riots were sort of happened or planned, and the way after the riots, the kind of witch hunting the Delhi police has gone after. And I think we should stop saying this Delhi police or as if it is an amorphous institution. You know, we should start saying who is the officer who is concerned, who is doing it. If it is under a district, let's say, we should start thinking. I'm particularly currently not aware, but who is the DCP who is sending a notice to an NGO under UAPA? It's not the Delhi police. It's a particular officer. That officer will have to, you know, his name and position should be published, so that this is the officer who is doing this. And it cannot be on the constraints of the entire institutions. You can't just run the tide like that. But the way the Delhi police has behaved has been, of course, Delhi police has always behaved like this. Whenever there is a question of siding with the government comes up, the Delhi police has gone overboard and always sided with the government. So the targeting and the witch hunting has gone beyond. But more than the arrest part, I think, like in the case of Safura and the kind of character assassination that the, what you call the largest political party in the world has gone after. Just one person, one lady, and the entire party machinery being used to, tarnish her. It's not enough that she's arrested. Hmm. It's not enough that she's arrested while she's pregnant, but her image also has to be completely tarnished across the. So the kind of the vileness, the kind of extent to which they would go to finish somebody's character, I think that was the more dangerous part. Going to jail, I think thousands of people have gone to jail before, lakhs of people have gone to jail before. Many of us would also go to jail. And I, for one, can speak, sitting in my home, that I am ready to go. I have no second thoughts on that. I have decided that if I speak up, there will be consequences and I'm ready to bear it, whatever may be. But I'm also clear that that's not the end of it. That's not the story, of India ends. This is a phase, and a phase shouldn't define a cycle. A generation shouldn't define a nation. So if there is a generation which is not capable enough to stand up for what they believe, I don't think that should get to define an entire nation. Another generation would come and they would not be afraid of speaking to power. I think that includes media, that includes judiciary, that includes All India Service officers, and another generation would definitely come. And at least for them to share that there were people who fought before also, we need to do this.
And you resigned in protest against the clampdown of Article 370 in Kashmir. And now Kashmir people are under a lockdown within a lockdown since last year. How do you see the situation the Kashmir people is under, especially during the COVID-19 lockdown?
See, as I have said the last time when I resigned also, is that very clearly, 370 or not is a separate question. 370 being, whether the special status being abrogated or 370 being amended is a separate question. But the fact that a government could simply go ahead and say that, okay, we'll shut down an entire state, there won't be any fundamental rights or freedom of expression or freedom of movement, or none of that would be there in the state, because we want people to choose between life and liberty. They said, so we are doing all this to protect, so that we can protect their lives. So effectively, they are telling to an entire population that you choose, you want liberty or you want life. You can only get one. You can't get both. And this is a trade-off. You know, once in a while, for a 1 day or 2 day or 2 day, 15 day, you are ready to do it. But it is not possible that the government is saying we'll do it for months and years along. So a wrong, prolonged wrong can become a normal, but a prolonged wrong cannot become right. Now, it cannot become right just because it is continuing. It will start looking like a normal, just like lockdowns have started becoming like normal for all of us, that, okay, this is the new normal. It will become normal, but it will not become right. You know, I don't think, and it has been for, I think in another 10 days, we'll be having 1 year completion of that, you know, what, prolonged. Until now, I think we are not able to even restore the internet facilities, despite the Supreme Court ruling that access to services through internet is actually a fundamental right, but did not give a remedy. It said that, okay, it is a fundamental right. That means the violation that is happening, there is a violation of fundamental right, but the judiciary stopped short of providing relief. I don't think that's sort of a judgment we would want our judiciary to be characterized with. If you are clearly saying there is a violation, then you should also provide a relief and a remedy to it. So it has been tremendous, but I don't think just because I took a decision on the you know, aftermath of abrogation of 370 and the kind of clampdown the government did, I don't think I should be the person to speak on behalf of or you know, on Kashmiris and what they must be going through. I don't find it is my place to do that. One thing I can say is that it defines not on Kashmir, but it defines us as a country, that we are ready to suspend a population's fundamental right, our own, which we said our own constitution guarantees, we are ready to suspend it for something which is saying it's in national interest. Or so it becomes, when we make anything a national interest project, that means the people's or citizens' fundamental rights can be suspended. All that we need to establish, okay, this is in greater good, this is a national interest. So the rest of the people should be immediately you know, ready to give away your rights. And that is a very dangerous proposition. This, you know, we are fighting all throughout, establishing a nation on the condition that these rights are always of the citizens. In the country or the government can never take away those rights. That is a, you know, precondition of establishing a democratic republic state. And now it seems we are at the mercy of the government. When the government wants, you will have the right. When the government does not want, you will. It did not stop at Kashmir, I would say. You had seen the kind of clampdown which happened during the CANRC movement across the country. I was not allowed to speak at 3 or 4 places. Just, you know, just going there was itself. I'm a citizen of this country and we are not doing anything crime. We're just speaking on issue. And when speaking on issue was not allowed. Later, you just see the migrant labor crisis which happened. The people whom the government is supposed to serve and protect and provide for, they were put in a place of which are really hotspot places like Mumbai, Surat, or even Delhi.
Yeah, and then, that brings to my next question. Like you said, the case of migrant workers. So do you think the welfare of marginalized is not a priority for this government?
No, it's not it's not that it is a priority or not a priority. It is just this. When we say it is a priority, it is a priority. When it is not a priority, you know, it's always the government is the priority. The government is the priority. Government's image is the priority. What the government decides is the priority. It is not the rights of the citizen. It's not what, you know, what is their opinion. None of that. So this is where the differentiation comes. Because in the migrant crisis case, so it was not a, what do you call, a communal issue, like this government has been portrayed in a particular communal frame. But this was not a communal issue. This was for everybody was there. And government said, no, you would not go out. And they were not provided with food. They were not, large section were not provided with food or water or any other facilities. They were staying in positions, especially in big cities like this. They were staying in, if you're a construction worker, you would be staying in a tin shed. You will not be staying in a proper house because you are migrated, you are doing at a construction site, you are made tin shed construction, then you are staying there. You are sharing a toilet, you are sharing a kitchen, and that is how you have been staying. And when the COVID came, the first places to be hit were these cities. And it is where there precisely the government said, okay, you will not go out, you will be staying there. Okay, they stayed there for a long time, but they understood that there is no end to it and there is nothing, they cannot survive here. And they wanted to go back. So we said, no. No train, no bus would be arranged. some in Delhi government or some officers tried to arrange bus for them, and two IAS officers of Delhi government are still suspended. It's been, I think, 4 months now. They still remain suspended for providing buses. They provided buses to these migrant workers. For that, they are still suspended. Because when they provided buses, people came together, you know, that and it was creating a big image issue for the government. And they did not provide train, they did not provide bus. And then the people, I've been staying from, you know, staying in Mumbai, I'm seeing people from here going to Ahmedabad, you know, Allahabad, walking from here. They did not protest. They did not ask the government that how dare you not provide any of the services. You are not allowing us to work. You are not allowing us to, you know, go out and earn some money for ourselves. You are not providing us with anything. And you are not letting us go back also. See, you have been temporarily put under jail. So when they started walking back, you know what the government did? Like in Haryana, the government said those people who are walking should be put in a stadium, and the stadium should be made into a jail, and these people should be arrested and put in a jail. These people who are walking from this place and going back to Allahabad, they were beaten up at every border. Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh border, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh border. Police was literally lathi charging these people. Were they protesting? Were they saying anything against the government? No. They were just going back to their homes, you know, their own homes. So this doesn't end at some place. This is like, how dare you? You know, we have given an order, we have given a direction. How dare you oppose it? Without realizing that what is the reason the citizen is actually staying up. So what you are seeing is effectively going back to a subject. We are no more a citizen. You know, we are more or less a subject. We are at the mercy. As long as the government says you have a right to say something, you can say. The government decides no, you can't, then we are at the mercy. So this is where the distinction of a subject and a citizen comes. And we are getting reduced to subjects. We have never been a full citizen anyway. But now we are, I think, further going back to the subject thing. This is dangerous for us as a country. You know, many of us have a misnomer or a notion that a strong government means a strong country. No, it's a strong citizenry that creates a strong country. It's not a strong government. Often strong governments and strong nation are antithetical to each other. What you need is a strong citizenry. And to have a strong citizenry, you need strong institutions. You need strong institutions in the sense of judiciary, independent institutions of media. You know, that is how you become a strong nation. But somehow the government feels that a strong government is equivalent to a strong nation, and government is equivalent to a nation. And this is where I think we have gone wrong. But I am very, you know, I don't see things in a month or 6 month or an yearly time frame. Because if that is the way, then we will be really depressed if you are just going to see this in a 6 month or a 1 year time frame. We need to see this as a part of a 5 year, 10 year period, or, you know, at least a prolonged period through which we might have to struggle. But ultimately, you know, I think we are weaker and stronger out of this. I don't think we are going to go back as long as we are ready to fight for it. As long as we are ready to fight for it.
Yeah, and do you still anticipate the revival of anti-CAA NRC movement as the COVID situation improves in the country?
It will depend on the government. If the government is not, because the government has suspended NPR and NRC. NRC, NPR as a, when I say NPR, it's actually just a part of NRC. I don't see an NPR and NRC as two distinct, different processes, because NPR's existence comes from a rule, NRIC rules, which is actually made for creation of NRC. So the NPR, the government has actually kept in abeyance for now. So if the government is going to go ahead with the NPR in the way it has, at least more than 10 states had come out and strongly opposed the way the NPR was being done. But if the government is still going to go ahead after the COVID situation improves, then I think we'll see, because I don't think for the government or for the people, NPR should be a priority now, because we need to get out of this space as a country, as the COVID thing. After that, it's up to the government. If there is no NPR, it's a CA thing. Still, CA is something to be protested against, because it is against the constitutional values. It is against the secular values of the country. It needs to be protested against, and it needs to be fought also. I think it is in the Supreme Court, and that fight also should continue. But the immediate threat of an NPR NRC process at least has been pushed away, and that also goes to a large credit to the movement, which continued for a long period, because there was a pressure across the country. I'm hopeful that government won't touch it immediately.
Yeah, and moving to my last question. right now we have a crisis of hatred. There is a crisis of hunger, a crisis of nowhere to go. So what would you like to tell the government?
No, I think first is to create trust. Don't treat your own countrymen or compatriots as enemies. And it has to come from the government, because government and its party missionaries and the IT cell or the kind of... because they think they're just doing a job. They're taking some money and then just writing random comments on people and trying to create hatred, asking them to go to Pakistan or China or something. They're not realizing that by portraying everybody as an enemy to the country, you are actually weakening your own nation. Your compatriots cannot be your enemies. You can have your difference of opinion. This is just for me also. People who are having a difference of opinion with me on a lot of issues, I don't see them as enemies. Ultimately, they are the very people I need to convince. It's they are not the people I need to defeat. No, it's not that I need to defeat them or I need to defeat them and win over them. No, I would consider that I need to convince them. I need to convince them of my values, and I need to win them over to my side. I need to talk to them. I need to tell that why we are taking this position, because it is in the interest of humanity. It is in the interest of our nation. It is in the interest of everyone included. The hate doesn't, hate takes a lot of energy. It takes, because you are continuously anger. It is continuously, it gives you adrenaline. It gives you satisfaction of, I have shown something, somebody, I have said something to somebody, but it is also taking a toll on your own brain. I've seen many of my friends who are on the right wing, going so much into anger due to this hatred. They keep watching my own videos and just write very hateful comments on my videos and still being my friends. It's not that they're not, we'll still have calls and say, why are you writing all this? You say all these things, we don't accept all this. So it's fine, you can disagree, but why do you have to portray me as some sort of an enemy? I'm not your enemy. We have difference of opinion. I think the hatred project should be from one side. We should not make the hatred project from both sides. I think that is where we need to be very careful about. Of course, this is a fight, and but the way to do it is by creating more and more consensus on the values that we have. Create more of convincing other more and more people on the values that we are having, and I think these values are very strong. I have full faith in the values that I am standing for. And if I am able to convince, if I am able to tell properly to more and more people, I am pretty sure. And in the process, maybe I may have to revise one or two of my stances. There would be one or two of my positions which I had an opinion about, for which they would be correct, which is fine. But I think that is how the way to go forward. This constant hate is something will weaken our country. It will definitely weaken. And it will be a foolish thought to actually think the political opposition or ideological opposition within the country is your enemy. You have your ideological opinion, but there are actually enemies to our country. It's not the case that, as you have seen recently with the China episode, there are people outside of our country who are waiting for a chance to nibble our territory or create unrest or some sort of a thing. So if you keep creating your own, treating your own people as your enemies, then I think it's a country that weakens. But that is something we need to work on. I don't expect the government, or I've literally given up on the government or the party in power to ever understand this or work on it. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't work on it. So I've been trying. I've taken a break for a month or so. I've been learning some languages and other things, I think. But this is a long fight. I don't think we need to define it in a week or a month time.
Thank you so much, sir, for speaking to Grounded Voices. That was Kannan Gopinathan at twocircles.net, the mainstream news of the marginalized. Thank you, sir.